Hey guys, I am Venkat and this is part 19 of web development with Blazor video series. In this video, we'll discuss how to implement all the CRUD operations, that is create, read, update and delete in ASP.NET Core Blazor. In our previous video, part 18, we discussed how to enable support for CRUD operations in a data grid. Please watch that video before proceeding. Now, if you recollect from our previous video in this series, on this data grid, we made three changes to enable CRUD operations. And here is the first change. We need to tell this data grid among these columns, which column is the primary key column. In our case, employee ID is the primary key column. And to specify that on this grid column, we have set is primary key equals true. And here is the second change. We included this grid edit settings component with these three properties: allow adding, allow editing, and allow deleting. And the third change is here. At the data grid level, we have set toolbar property to a new string array with these strings in it: add, edit, update, etc. So at this point, if we take a look at this page in the browser, notice we have a toolbar with these buttons: add, edit, update, etc. And in the footer, we can see at the moment in the underlying database table, we have 33 rows. Now let's add a new row by clicking this button and provide a value for first and last name, date of birth, department, gender, and email. And then before we click update button, let's take a look at Visual Studio output window. So in the output window, make sure you have your web server selected. And at the moment, we can see we only have two select queries, first select query and second select query. Now let's click the update button. And then let's also try to edit this second row. Let's set first and last name to John 1 and Hastings 1. Click the update button. And let's also delete this third row. Select the row, click the delete button. Now it looks like all these three operations, insert, update, and delete, have been performed. If we take a look at Visual Studio output window again, notice we only have those two select queries. We don't have any of the insert, update, or delete SQL statements. This means all these operations are performed only at the data grid level. They are not persisted to the database table. We can prove that very easily by reloading this web page. Notice everything is reverted back. We still have 33 employees table in the data grid table, and we have included one in John's first and last name, and we have deleted this Sam's record. But all these are reverted back. So what we really want to do is save these changes in the underlying database table. So let's look at the steps required for that. To be able to save the changes that we make at the data grid level in the underlying database table, we need to handle grid events. And for that, we include this component, grid events. And the event that we want to handle is on action begin. And then let's specify the event handler name as action begin handler. Obviously, we can give it any meaningful name we want. We don't have this event handler method yet. We'll create it in just a bit. And we also have to tell this component the type of object the grid is working with. In our case, we know it is employee object. Our obvious next step is to include this event handler. Let's do that in the code block at the bottom right here. Public, async, void, the name of the method, and this method is going to receive a parameter of type action event args of employee. Let's call the parameter args. Now, here's the important bit to keep in mind. On the data grid, when we perform any of the operations like add, edit, update, etc., we know this event on action begin is raised, and this is the event handler method. So in the event handler, we have to identify the type of CRUD operation that is being performed. And for that, you can use this incoming arguments parameter. If args.requestType.equals syncfusion.blazor.grids.action. We can see all the actions like save, add, etc. So let's identify if it is the save action. What is being saved? Is it the add operation or the edit operation? Again, for that, on the incoming arguments parameter, we have action, If it is equal to add, then we know it is the add operation. In the data grid, when we add a new employee row and then click the update button, what we really want to do is add that employee in the underlying employees database table. And for that, we can use this injected employee service. On the employee service, we have add employee method. And obviously, to this method, we need to pass the employee object that we have added in the data grid. And to get that employee object, we can use this incoming args parameter. On that, we have data property. And again, from the IntelliSense, you can see it returns us the employee object. Else, on the employee service, we want to call update employee method. Just like how we are checking if the request type is save. By the way, if we go to the definition on this, we can see all the request types here. Now, what we want to do is check if the request type is delete. And for that, same idea, an if condition similar to this, what we already have on line number 58. So if the request type is delete, then we want to call delete employee method on our employee service. Now, if we take a look at this employee service, by the way, this employee service is present in the client project in the services folder right here. So if we take a look at add employee method, notice we don't have the implementation. So let's provide it. Create a variable. Let's call it response. And on the injected HTTP client, just like how we have get from JSON async method, we also have post as JSON async. Why post as JSON async? Well, that's because we are creating a new employee. And for that, we use the post method. Specify the REST API endpoint we want to post to. We know it is /API/employees and pass the incoming employee object. From the return type, we can see we want this method to return the newly added employee. So for that, return await. On the response object, we have content property, and on that we use read from JSON async, and we want to typecast the JSON to employee object, and we are using the await keyword here. So let's also turn this method into async. Along the same lines, let's provide implementation for delete employee method. Same idea, on the injected HTTP client, we're using delete async, and here is the URI, API/employees, and in the URI, we have to pass the ID of the employee that we are deleting. Since we are using await keyword, let's turn this method also into async. Finally, update employee. Same idea. The only difference is on the injected HTTP client, we use put as JSON async. Why? Because we are issuing an update. Again, we're using await keyword, so you know the drill. Convert the method to async. There we go. We have the data displayed as expected. Let's edit this first employee row. Include one in both the first and last name. Let's change the date of birth to 1st of August, department to payroll, gender to female, and include one again in the email. And then before we click the update button, let's clear everything that we have in the output window and then click the update button. Looks like the employee row is updated. So if we take another look at Visual Studio output window, notice we have a parameterized SQL update statement here, and we can confirm the data is updated in the underlying database by reloading this web page. Notice the first employee row, we have the changes persisted, and we can double confirm this by issuing a select query to our database table. Take a look at this first row, data updated as expected. Next, let's try out the delete operation. First, take a look at the data grid footer. We have 33 items. Let's delete this employee row. So we select the row and click the delete button. Before we do that, as usual, let's clear everything that we have in Visual Studio output window and then click the delete button. Looks like the row is deleted. We can see that in the data grid footer here. And if we take a look at Visual Studio output window, notice we have a delete SQL statement right here. And we can confirm the record is deleted again by issuing our select query. Notice at the bottom right here, we have 33 rows. So let's execute the select query. Now 32 rows. Finally, let's try add operation. Provide values for first and last name, date of birth, department, gender, and email. And before we click update button, let's clear the output window and then click update. Looks like the insert operation has succeeded, but we can say something is not quite right because the employee ID value is zero. We'll get to this in just a bit. And if we take a look at the output window in Visual Studio, we can see a parameterized SQL insert statement here. So we can be sure the row is inserted into the database table. But then if we take a look at the data grid footer, notice at the moment we have got 33 items in the grid. Now let's see what's going to happen when we reload this page. Notice the footer, 32 items, one item reduced. That's a bit weird. We'll come to that in just a bit. Let's quickly verify the number of rows that we have in the database table. Notice in the messages tab, we can see we have 33 rows. And if we scroll all the way down, we can see our newly inserted row here. And the data is also correct for all these columns. First name, last name, email, date of birth, gender. Notice department ID. This is taking the default integer value, which is zero. It did not take the department that we have selected in the drop-down list. And that's because of a bug that we have in employee repository. And the employee repository file is present in the models folder. So let's open this. And if we take a look at the add employee method, the bug that we have is because of this if block. If employee.department is not equal to null, we are basically setting employee.department entity state to unchanged. So this is not allowing us to use the department that we have selected in the drop-down list. So to fix it, I'm going to change this code. If employee.department ID is equal to zero, that means the end user did not provide a valid department ID. So let's throw a new exception. And the exception message is employee department ID cannot be zero. Else, we want to check if a valid department ID is provided. And for that, we need to inject department repository. So let's include a private read-only field. We need a constructor parameter of the same type. So let's copy and paste this. And then this dot department repository equals the constructor parameter. And then in the else block, let's create a variable of type department. Let's call it department. On the injected department repository, we have getDepartment method. To it, let's pass the employee department ID. If the department variable is equal to null, that means an invalid department ID is provided. So let's throw a new exception with the message invalid employee department ID. And to make debugging easier, let's also include that invalid department ID in the message. On the other hand, if this variable is not null, that means a valid department is provided. So let's set the employee department to the variable. Now, before we try the add operation, let's clean up invalid data that we have in the employees database table. Take a look at this last row with employee ID 59. We have department ID 0, which is invalid. So let's delete this row. Here's the query for that. Execute it. Row deleted. Let's select the data. At the moment, we have 32 rows. Now try the add operation. Provide values for first and last name, department payroll, gender female, t@t.com. Click update. Looks like the row is inserted, but still the employee ID value is zero. Let's select the data from the database table. Notice we have 33 rows now. And if you scroll all the way to the bottom, we have our new employee row. And notice the department ID is correctly stored as expected. But why the ID value is still zero here? Well, that's because after the insert operation, we are not reloading the data and refreshing the grid. So let's do that now. In our grid edit razor component, after we add the new employee row, we want to reload data from the server and populate this employees property. Why do we need to populate this employees property? Well, that's because it is this employees property that our grid is binding to. And we already have code for that in onInitialized async method. So let's copy this line and paste it right here. After we reload the data, we also want to refresh the data grid. And for that, we need a property that references the data grid. So let's create a property of type sfgrid. And we know the grid is working with employee objects. And let's call this property employee grid. And then on the grid itself, we include href and then specify our property there. And then in this if block here, after the data is reloaded on the employee grid, we call refresh method, which refreshes the data grid. Let's try add operation again. We have a small problem here. When adding a new employee row, there's no need to supply a value for employee ID column. Why? Well, ID column is an identity column in the database. This means when a new row is inserted, the database engine will automatically provide a value for this column. So it makes sense to keep this column disabled in the data grid. And it's very easy to do. On the respective grid column, in our case, on employee ID column, set allow adding equals false. Try add operation again. ID column disabled as expected. Let's provide test values for all these columns. Click update. Notice the data grid footer, the number of rows are updated as expected. And if we go to the last page, we have our new test row there, and we can reconfirm this by executing select query on our database table. And if we scroll all the way to the end, we can see our new row here. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.